Welcome to episode 10 of Staging Shakespeare, and thanks very much for listening. I'm calling this episode Twins, and that means it's going to be about two plays that Shakespeare wrote about 7 years apart, The Comedy of Errors and Twelfth Night. In fact, I was in the middle of directing a production of Twelfth Night back in February 2020, when the COVID-19 pandemic put an end to all our rehearsals. The performances were due to take place in Abergavenny Castle in June 2020. Over a year later, these shows have been postponed for a second time because it wasn't possible to rehearse in the early part of 2021. So it's my hope that this production will eventually see the light of day in the summer of 2022. Anyway, that's partly why the problem of twins has been knocking around in my brain recently, and it seemed a good idea to share my thoughts on this problem with you. Plus, I've just booked to see The Comedy of Errors in Stratford this summer in the newly created Lydia and Manfred Gorvie Garden Theatre. This will be our first trip to a live theatre performance since COVID struck. It seems almost unbelievable. So many months without theatre performed live. So I can't wait to see what the Royal Shakespeare Company will be serving up in August. The comic potential of twins is by no means restricted to Shakespeare. In fact, as recently as the 1980s, there was an American buddy movie called Twins, directed by Ivan Reitman and starring Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito as the eponymous brothers. The comedy in this case revolved around the fact that DeVito and Schwarzenegger were so totally unalike in terms of appearance. Most twin stories, though, are predicated on similarity, and that's the case for the brothers Menechmus, the comedy by the Roman playwright Plautus on which Shakespeare based The Comedy of Errors. And it seems most appropriate to start with this play, as it's the earlier of the two that Shakespeare wrote featuring twins. At the point when Shakespeare wrote The Comedy of Errors, he was already firing on all cylinders. He'd written the hugely popular Henry VI plays and Richard III, as well as The Taming of the Shrew and The Two Gentlemen of Verona. He'd even written the bloody Senecan drama Titus Andronicus. So although he hadn't started to produce what we would confidently call tragedies yet, he'd certainly got some histories and comedies under his belt already. As many of you will probably know, when Shakespeare decided to produce a version of the brothers Menechmus, he sent himself an additional and completely unnecessary challenge. In the Plautine original, there is a single set of twin brothers, Menechmus of Epidamnus and Menechmus of Syracuse. Shakespeare renames these brothers Antipholus of Ephesus and Antipholus of Syracuse, but gives each of them a servant named Dromio, who are also twin brothers. In consequence, he creates the potential for double the confusion and, of course, double the comedy. But for a director, it's a double nightmare. Not only do I need to find two similar actors to play the Antipholuses, but I also need another pair to play the Dromios. And that makes me start to wonder, what did Shakespeare himself do when The Comedy of Errors first made an impact on the Elizabethan stage? I haven't come across any suggestion that Shakespeare's theatre company, the Chamberlain's Men, later the King's Men, had amongst its actors a pair of twins. well, let alone two pairs of twins for the Comedy of Errors. So I think we have to conclude that Shakespeare's own actors had to face up to exactly the same problem that many contemporary directors face. How do I make these twins appear similar enough to be mistaken for one another, given that the actors playing these parts are not identical, even though they probably look more similar than DeVito and Schwarzenegger? As the Comedy of Errors is little more than a rough and tumble farce, then it's no surprise that most productions resort to a combination of costume and makeup, often quite exaggeratedly so. If your costuming and makeup are sufficiently exaggerated, it's less of a problem casting identical looking twins, of course. The first production of the play that I saw was Trevor Nunn's for the Royal Shakespeare Company in 1976. Mike Gwillim and Roger Rees played the two Antipholuses, and the Dromios were played by Nicholas Grace and Michael Williams. If you do an internet search for this production, you'll find that it's now described as being a musical, with book and lyrics by Trevor Nunn, and music by Guy Wolfenden. I have to say that this came as a bit of a surprise. Correction, it came as a shock. I do remember that the production featured a number of songs and a lot of music, but I think that most of the dialogue, what's referred to in the case of musicals as the book, was actually written by someone called William Shakespeare, and not by Mr. Nunn. Talk about cheeky, Trevor! Leaving aside Mr. Nunn's appropriation of the provenance of the text, the key point of interest for us is the presentation of the twins in this production. Rees and Gwillim were dressed similarly, in white linen outfits with shirts featuring a checked collar. In terms of makeup, there was nothing special to help with the process of creating similarity in the case of the Antipholuses. The Dromios, on the other hand, were more fully designed. Each had a slightly punkish ginger wig, something which worked very effectively as an identifying characteristic. They wore matching t-shirts with colourful designs and patch trousers with braces. Combining all these features together created a successful and comic pairing. Indeed, a clownish look was achieved, and this has been a frequent choice for the Dromios, with some productions going the whole hog, giving them white faces and red noses. All of which works very well, given the farcical nature of the plot in this play. But nothing prepared me for the approach taken by the RSC in 1990, a wonderfully inventive production directed by Ian Judge. I saw this production at the Barbican Centre in London, which was at that time the RSC's London home. Looking in the programme, waiting for the show to start, I was puzzled to find that only one actor, Desmond Barrett, was playing both Antipholus of Syracuse and Antipholus of Ephesus. Similarly, only one actor was playing the Dromios, Graham Turner. Knowing the play well, I knew that this was technically possible right up to the very last scene, when the plot requires that both Antipholuses and both Dromios should be on stage simultaneously, face to face. How on earth would that be possible if Barrett and Turner were playing both roles? Throughout the production, Barrett and Turner achieved marvels. The set featured a collection of doors, and Barrett would exit through one door as Antipholus of Syracuse and enter through another door at the other side of the stage as his long-lost twin brother almost immediately. Quite simply, behind the set and out of sight of the auditorium, he must have been running like a mad thing from door to door. But it worked spectacularly. And the audience was enraptured by the cleverness of it all. And it made the mistaken identity problem disappear entirely. Of course, it was possible to mistake one Dromio for another, as both were played by the same actor. Of course, both Dromios and both Antipholuses were perfectly identical twins. But all the time, the final scene was coming ever closer, with the seeming impossibility of Turner and Barrett actually duplicating themselves. And it was at that point that Ian Judge treated us to his masterstroke. Without warning, two body doubles appeared for the last scene and stood downstage centre with their backs to the audience. We couldn't see their faces, but we could see their bodies. It was like pulling a rabbit, or rather two rabbits, out of a hat. But it did divide opinions. Some critics thought it was a swizz, an anti-climax, given the play moves inexorably to the moment when both sets of twins are simultaneously on stage and visible. I, on the other hand, found it simply marvellous. Like the rabbit out of the hat, it was a kind of conjuring trick. We knew all along that Barrett and Turner couldn't be in two places at once, even though for most of the performance it seemed as if they could be. So I applauded the ingenuity of this solution to the problem of the twins in the Comedy of Errors. And Ian Judge's production gets top marks from me for that stroke of genius. Oh, and it was hilarious throughout, which is what it should be. But of course, Twelfth Night is an entirely different kettle of fish. And it's a much more complex piece of work in terms of characterization and thematic material. So, although I said at the beginning of this podcast that I'd be looking at both The Comedy of Errors and Twelfth Night, I've now decided that it makes little or no sense to try to cram my thoughts about Twelfth Night into the little time I have left for this episode. So I'll be following up this podcast on twins with a sequel, Twins 2, which makes it start to sound a bit like a movie franchise, I suppose. Oh, and one other quick thing before I finish. I've been reading an interesting book recently published by Cambridge University Press. It's by David McInnes and is entitled Shakespeare and Lost Plays. McInnes points out that, generally, plays featuring twins tend to be comedies, with the twins providing much of the laughs. But this isn't entirely the case. Two of the plays in the repertoire of The King's Men featured twins, but not in a comic way. One was Extant, The Duchess of Malfi, by John Webster, in which the Duchess herself is a twin and her twin brother is the villainous Ferdinand, Duke of Calabria. The other is a lost play, known as The Twins' Tragedy. Precisely what was the nature of the twins in this play and what was their tragedy cannot now be ascertained, given that the only information to survive about the play and its subject matter is the title, recorded in a chamber accounts warrant dated 20th of May 1613. The Twins' Tragedy was performed, along with 19 other plays, as part of the 1612 to 1613 season of court entertainments, commissioned at a time when James I was playing host to Frederick V, the Elector Palatine, who was in England to be engaged to James's daughter Elizabeth Stuart. The marriage taking place on the 14th of February 1613. What the married couple thought of the Twins' Tragedy is not recorded. So that's all for episode 10. Please do remember that you can email me at podcaststagingshakespeare@gmail.com. I do hope you've enjoyed thinking about twins in the Comedy of Errors, and Twelfth Night follows in Twins 2. Thanks for listening. Bye now.